And in the end, once they took me back into the actual procedure room and it got real, the veil was cleared from my eyes, and I saw what was happening and what I was doing. And I changed my mind, and I said, I can't do this. Keep the money. Just let me go. I'm done here. And they wouldn't let me. They said no. Wow. They called for backup. I ended up with a person on each arm, person on each leg, staff member. I'm trying to scream. They're trying to get me to be quiet.
Wow.
And they forcibly aborted my baby.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, and welcome to this edition of the Dr. J Show. My guest today is Catherine Glenn Foster, who is president of Americans United for Life, which is one of the country's foremost legal strategists for dealing with the pro-life issue. Catherine, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Pleasure to be here.
Well, great. Listen, I was drawn to you because of the story that you wrote in USA Today about your own experience with abortion. Would you just briefly, if you don't mind, you know, you're the president of a big organization and you have lots of credentials and responsibility, but your story as a mom and as a woman, I think, is really compelling. So would you just briefly share that story with people?
Sure. You know, it involves going back to college. Back in 2001, I was 19 years old, and I was a sophomore at a little college in Georgia, and I found out that I was pregnant. I was in shock. I had no idea what to do. I had no idea where to turn. I was embarrassed, scared, I felt helpless and more vulnerable than I ever had in my entire life. And not knowing where to turn, I turned to the internet, and I went online that night, and I searched pregnant and need help online. And what came up were abortion facilities. You know, now I'm so pleased to say that usually some of the first results that come up when you Google pregnant or abortion or anything like that, you're going to find pregnancy centers. You're going to find real, holistic, life-affirming help. But I found abortion facilities, and so I took a look at them, and I picked one. It was the second cheapest one. I thought, okay, this has got to be a little bit safer than the absolute cheapest. I didn't know what I was going to do,
This is the thought process of a 19-year-old.
Exactly. Right. It was right. Just, okay, I got to go in somewhere. I'm in an emergency situation. How fast can I get in and talk with someone? Because I actually found out back in my school's health clinic, the University College health clinic, and I didn't find a whole lot of resources there. You know, I didn't find, okay, here's what happens if you're pregnant and parenting, here's what you do with housing and meal plan and none of that. It was just, okay, we're going to give you a test. I had gone in for a sinus infection or something, and they said, okay, just, we're going to give you a test. Take the test. They said, you're pregnant. And I remember even just then, just sitting on that table and being in shock and you know, expecting help, expecting resources or something. And you could see in their eyes that they wanted to say something, but they didn't. And so I was left on my own to Google late at night to make this appointment. And that was my thought process. It was just find some place to go, get more information. I had no idea. I was an only child, no real experience with babies, but I knew that I needed information. I didn't know what I was going to do, but I did know that if I did end up getting an abortion, it was going to have to be fast, because even that week I was already bonding with my child. So thinking back on that week, I was walking around campus. I was wearing my then boyfriend's oversized Timberland sweatshirt and I was talking to my child and trying to comfort her and myself as I was walking around. I even named her.
Wow.
And then that Saturday, you know, I made this journey from campus in pretty rural Georgia, small town Georgia, down closer to Atlanta, closer to where I was from. And I walked through those doors. And from that point forward, that was, it feels like that really was where my life changed and mm-hmm. where things went wrong, you know, mm-hmm. Because pregnancy life, that there can be so much hope there. There's so much possibility that there's a reason why there's that phrase, pregnant with possibility. But when you walk through the doors of death, nothing feels right anymore. And I got no information there. I got no care, no compassion. I was still trying to make up my mind. And so you take a pill first, a painkiller. And so I did that, and they took me back and they had me lie down and they did this ultrasound, and they were trying to see how far along I was. I asked to see it. You know, it's what, 2 feet from my face, and the screen was turned away from me. And so I asked them to turn the screen or if I could see it. I'm craning my neck, trying to see this ultrasound. And they said no. They said it was against their policy to allow women, to allow girls to see our ultrasounds. We know why.
Right.
Because
right.
when we see our children, that's another part of that bonding experience.
Right, right, right.
That's how.
How long, may I ask, how long ago was that, Catherine?
19 years.
19 years ago. So that would have been, 2001?
2001, yeah. Okay. So we would be right about at the time of celebrating my child's 19th birthday, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Probably this month, late last month, early this month. But they didn't let me see my
right,
ultrasound.
Right.
They didn't,
because some places do now. Yeah. Some places actually
right.
require people to see the, to be able
exactly.
to see the ultrasound.
Yeah, more and more states are passing laws requiring
right.
that women at least be allowed to see the ultrasound if we ask,
right.
or even offer to
right.
let us see our ultrasounds. Mm-hmm. But back then, that wasn't true in Georgia. That wasn't true in my experience.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I wasn't able to see the ultrasound. I was asking questions. They didn't answer my questions. It was just wall of silence after wall of silence. And in the end, once they took me back into the actual procedure room and it got real, the veil was cleared from my eyes, and I saw what was happening and what I was doing. And I changed my mind. And I said, I can't do this. Keep the money. Just let me go. I'm done here. And they wouldn't let me. They said no.
Wow.
They called for backup. I ended up with a person on each arm, person on each leg, staff member. I'm trying to scream. They're trying to get me to be quiet.
Wow.
And they forcibly aborted my baby. At that point, I lost hope. I lost choice. I lost autonomy. I lost my sense of empowerment. They took me back to the recovery room and I just sat there and cried. I didn't want to leave. I knew that was going to be the last time I would ever be in the same building as that baby.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, all my choice, all my sense of empowerment was just stripped from me in that facility. And that decision has been with me every day since. It's colored everything that I've done since.
Wow. Wow. So when you walked through that door, it was like you got on a conveyor belt. And there was no stepping off. It's like the Hotel California. You can
exactly.
check out, but you can't leave. You know, you're
right.
That's what you're doing. So, have you heard other stories from other women comparable to yours, Catherine?
I have. Yeah. For a time, I thought surely I must be alone.
Right.
Surely it's just me. I was. The process of healing was tough.
Mm-hmm.
Just to go back a little bit again. So one of the reasons why I ended up proceeding was just because I was afraid. You know, that's how I ended up listening to them, because I was hearing what they were telling me about, here's what your life will be like if you don't get this abortion.
Is that right? They would actually tell you that? They were actually coaching you along as to what your life would be like? Okay.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So that was a big part of how I let myself just sort of almost until I check out and allow myself to go along on that conveyor belt. Mm-hmm. I ended up beginning to share a bit about my story. I told my mom soon afterwards.
Good. Yeah. Good.
I was so scared of disappointing her. Mm-hmm. That was one of the parts that really hurt worst for me, is that, she raised me as a single mom, and I couldn't imagine her only daughter disappointing her. Mm-hmm. But you know, I'm a mama's girl, and I can't not tell my mama things. And so mm-hmm. a few weeks later, I was on the phone with her from college, and the whole story just spilled out. And she was just wonderful, so mm-hmm. understanding, so loving. She helped me find counseling at mm-hmm. what it turns out was a pregnancy center. I didn't piece that together at the time. I just thought, okay, I'm getting counseling somewhere, but I got post-abortion counseling, and that was wonderful. It was a really important part of my healing journey.
Yes.
So I began speaking out about what happened to me more and more over the years. And the more I have, the more I've heard from women on the streets, in Starbucks, yeah. in the church, about their abortion stories. And so many women have shared with me.
Yes.
You know, I had an abortion when I was young. I had two. I had three. I had more. And sometimes even their husbands don't know. It's such a hidden, mm-hmm. a secret part of them. And so I've been able to share with them about that healing journey and how much it would help them to share with trusted individuals, like a loving spouse. And so we've been able to keep in touch, and I've been able to mentor some of these precious women. Mm-hmm. Some of them have had stories that are remarkably similar to mine. I've met them across the country over the years, and sometimes I'll hear these stories of women who were denied their request to see an ultrasound, just not offered, but they specifically asked, like I did, and mm-hmm. that was denied. And that's heartbreaking, because
it's heartbreaking.
Yes.
And it tells you the people in the clinics don't believe their own rhetoric about choice. I mean,
right.
they're doing something else, you know.
Exactly.
Whatever they
it's
tell themselves. Yeah, whatever they tell themselves, that's not the whole story of what
exactly.
of what they're doing, you know.
Yes. Now, so
you know,
clearly a baby.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
So clearly it's a baby. It's not just a clump of cells. It's not
that's
just a
right.
mass of tissue. And so I hear from women who share that they were denied. I hear from women who sometimes who have likewise been even held down and forcibly aborted. And this is... it's tragically part of the story of abortion in America. It's a story that we at Americans United for Life are tracking, we're keeping tabs on, and we're documenting in resources and in stories and in healing resources.
So I want to finish this piece about healing. And then I want to move on to the legal strategies and the things that you're involved in at Americans United for Life, because my colleague, Father Paul Sullins, is a sociologist. I don't know if you're familiar with Father Paul and his work, but he produced a study where he looked at women aborting wanted pregnancies. Mm-hmm. He had a data set where you could tell, did they want this pregnancy, and you know, so on and so forth. And what he found was that women are psychologically traumatized and harmed at greater rates if they're aborting a wanted pregnancy. And in the minds of the Guttmacher Institute and those kind of people, that's like a null category. It can't even be that you would abort a wanted baby. These are only unwanted babies, you know, mm-hmm. and so they can't even track. But Father Paul, in doing that research, it's very clear, you know, that many women are in various ways pressured. Now, you weren't pressured from the outside, but a lot of women are, and I'm sure you guys track that at AUL too, right?
Absolutely, yes. And I would just say how grateful I am for Father Paul's research on this. Oh. It's true. So many abortions take place of wanted babies. Not that should be even the barometer, that shouldn't be the metric, for this, because a human being is a human being. But it's true that so many women express a special kind of pain when they did get that pressure from the outside, not just from the facility like me, but so often from a partner, from an intimate partner, from family members, from parents. And I've worked with women in these situations and tried to help them to restore their agency and their rights and stand up for themselves, because it is, it's incredibly traumatic, and that just compounds the trauma and the need for healing afterwards. When you hear these stories of the lengths that people will go to, it really has a spiritual element, I think. But this is one of my favorite parts about traveling across the nation is meeting other post-abortive women who are healing from the violence and the trauma of abortion, connecting with them, you know, sharing a cup of tea with them and sharing our stories, because post-abortion trauma is real.
That's right. It's very real. And, you know, the other thing that I would like to say to everyone watching, because we have people all across the country and, of course, around the world and, of course, across the spectrum, that when you've done something that you're ashamed of like this, that it's to say, I did this and I was wrong and I'm sorry, you know, that's really, really hard. But it's also really powerful. And this is what our Christian faith teaches us, that in that confession, in that repentance, and by speaking it, now you are vulnerable. That's true. You're very vulnerable. But then people respond to that. People come out of the woodwork to say, yeah, that happened to me. Thank you so much for saying that. And if you're sitting there all like this, all scared, you know, that's not going to happen, you know. So this is part of the Christian healing journey. That I just want to put that out there for people, you know, that whether you're post-abortive and that's the thing you're ashamed of, or whether you've been involved in a sexual relationship that you figured out later wasn't good for you, or you've been involved in a divorce, or, you know, whatever, all these crazy issues that the Ruth Institute deals with, this process is the same. You know, if you're willing to be repentant and to be at least somewhat open with some people, you're going to be blessed by that. And you're going to in turn become a blessing to other people, as I'm sure you've had that experience, Catherine, right? That people are so relieved to talk to you, right?
Exactly. And it almost, it brings some kind of redemption.
Yes,
right?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
So you're suffering as a sinner, right? And as a redeemed sinner, your suffering is united to the cross of Christ, and you make up what is lacking in the body, you know, and that's from Colossians. And we talk about that all the time, because it's a very real part of this process, I think. So tell us more then, if you would, about your journey that led you to become head of Americans United for Life. And then, of course, I want to hear about the mission of your organization so that people can get involved with what you guys are doing. How do you end up from a pregnant, scared, traumatized 19-year-old, how did you end up running the premier legal outfit in the United States on the pro-life cause? How did that happen, Catherine? There must have been a few grace steps along the way there, huh?
There were a few steps, yes. You know, I mentioned that that when I got that post-abortion counseling, I had no idea that it was at a pregnancy center. Yeah. I had no idea that pregnancy centers existed. That was one of those things that it would have been nice to have heard from my health center on campus, but,
And yeah, I'll bet you that the campuses are better on that. Wherever Kristen Hawkins is around, students... Students for Life, that's what they're just called, Students for Life. She's on that, you know, she's on that, making sure that more information and resources are available. So I'm just going to say that if your campus doesn't have good stuff like she's talking about, call Kristen.
There are resources out there. And in fact, just a couple of years ago, I found myself on my undergrad campus again. I was there for a conference and hadn't even put it together, but I hadn't been back in 16 years. And I was driving along the road up to the conference and drove past that health center. And it was one of those moments where I hit the brakes, I pulled over, I needed a minute. I took a minute to pray. Yeah. The next day I had a little more time. I went to that campus health center. And I went in and I started asking them, you know, I was a student here long ago. What would happen now? This is my story. What would happen now if a girl came in with a similar story? And it took them a minute. I think they first thought I might have been a plant. but they ended up, you know, sharing that they would share the appropriate resources. And I was so grateful for that. But in terms of myself, I didn't know. I was, I guess, naive. I had no idea that there was a movement. My best friend in Catholic school in sixth, seventh grade, she and her family were pro-life, but otherwise I just had no real connection or experience. I really hadn't heard the word abortion until I was 19.
Wow.
And so I knew after my experience, I knew how abhorrent it was. I knew that I could feel the pain of a soul being ripped out of me. It was, it was.
How far along were you?
Like no other.
Do you remember how about far along?
About five and a half weeks early.
Okay, really?
Yeah. Yeah, very, very early. In fact, originally with the ultrasound, they said it was too early. And I said, okay, well, there's my answer. I'll go ahead and leave. And they said, well, hang on a second. Let's check again. And they checked again. And they said, oop, far enough along after all. Go on to the next room.
Wow.
So I was very early on. But yeah, I knew how terrible it was for me. I knew how terrible that pain was. And I knew that was a life lost. But I didn't know that there was a pro-life movement. I didn't know that there was anyone else like me. And so it was years later, before I went to law school, I had pursued a whole different career in international work. And then I was taking time off to be home with my now almost 14-year-old daughter, who was actually next room over in the kitchen, doing a little cooking. But I was staying home with her, and I started to get this calling from God, like nothing I'd experienced before. Mm-hmm. And it started slow. First, it was okay, just go take the LSATs, the entrance test for law school. And I thought about it, prayed about it, ended up going and doing it. And that great check mark. I've done my job. God will be happy. and then I got this next calling. This really clear calling. Like, no, now you need to actually apply to law school. Yeah. Baby steps, right?
Step so, two.
Yeah.
Come on, girl.
Walking along that path. Yeah. So thought about it, prayed about it, applied. I got a call from Georgetown, and they said, we would love to have you. Will you take a spot? I got a call from the dean. And at that point I thought, okay, like this is a pretty clear path you've laid out for me, Lord. Yes. So I just immediately said, yes, I will accept that. Had no idea why I was going. And it wasn't until the orientation week of law school that I started to get an idea. During orientation week, they have different activities. I got to go to the National Arboretum and help clear vines off of trees and things like that. And they also had, they had bike rides. They had different immersive experiences. And they had a talk on healthcare law. And I was not thinking about abortion or the pro-life movement at all. Didn't know it existed still. But I was thinking, like, I don't know if you ever watched the TV show 24, Jack Bauer. I was really into it. And so I was thinking bioterrorism and, you know, like, I don't know, like very, very cool healthcare type things. And I thought, wow, that sounds really neat. So I go in, I'm sitting in the front row, and I got the clearest calling, the clearest voice I've had in my life. And it just said, you're here to save lives. You're here to save the moms, the mamas. You're here to save the babies. This is why I've called you here and put you in this place. And from that point on, I knew that was what I had to do. Had
so
no
wait,
idea how.
What did you hear in health law? Is that what it was called? Healthcare law?
It was about healthcare law. Yeah, it was. That talk was all about like health insurance and things
like that.
It was not related at all.
Okay. I thought maybe health law was going to be all about reproductive health or something like
no,
that.
No, actually, no. Yeah. Maybe it would have been nice to have at least made that connection, but no, it really wasn't. Not at that point. This was just, it was the Lord using
right.
this place he had led me to, and it was an incredible, a very humbling experience. I still had no idea that there was anyone like me. So basically my response was, yes, Lord, what am I to do here? Am I supposed to create a movement from scratch? I had no idea what was out there. Right. And so it was a couple of weeks later when they had sort of an on-campus organization, afternoon where they were different tables with the different campus organizations set up. And I saw one that said it was pro-life. And I said, huh, I wonder what that's about. I go over and I found out that there were other people like me, even at Georgetown. Mm-hmm. And I started talking with them and they said, yes, in fact, there's other whole organizations out there doing this work. And I'm just thinking, praise God, you know, this is incredible. And so I got involved with this group. They started introducing me to people, making connections, including with Charmaine Yost, my predecessor here at Americans United for Life, with Bill Saunders, another of our dear attorneys who's worked with us over the years, and so many other people in the life movement. I dove in head first, and pretty much everything I did from that point out, I still did some work on international law as well, but pretty much everything I did from that point out was relating to bioethics, to abortion. The classes I took, blessed to be at Georgetown, they had classes like epidemiology and the law, bioethics and the law, international bioethics and the law, social science, psychiatry, HIV AIDS, all these different courses that just, that really fed me and that allowed me to write a paper. Well, not a paper, a paper per class. So on average, probably more than 200 pages on abortion or related topics every semester. Mm-hmm. I was writing during law school, in addition to working, volunteering with the pro-life movement. I dove in headfirst, really. Mm-hmm. Ended up spending 7 years with Alliance Defending Freedom. I was a lawyer over there working on life issues. Uh-huh. And then came to AUL, to Americans United for Life, in spring of 2017. And it's incredible to be part of an organization that is 100% all in, dedicated to life. That's what we live and breathe. That's what we wake up in the morning doing. That's our calling. Right. And it is just a privilege to work with and to lead this incredible team.
So by this time, you have how many living children now?
Three.
You have three living children. Mm-hmm. In addition to your first child who's in heaven. Yes. And if I remember correctly, your USA Today article, you were writing in defense of Amy Coney Barrett. Is that right? Am I remembering this correctly? So finish that story, and then we're going back to AUL.
Amy Coney Barrett is she is an incredible inspiration, I think, to all women. Because, you know, Justice Ginsburg, back before she became a judge, before she became a justice, she was working for equality for women, for opportunities for women. And for me, that is the epitome of what Justice Barrett is living out. She's the perfect example of what Justice Ginsburg was fighting for. She is a strong, powerful, articulate, brilliant woman who has risen to the very, very top, to the pinnacle of the legal profession, right? And she's done it all while still giving her all at home, while having these seven precious children, these babies, these two adopted children from Haiti, one child who was diagnosed with Down syndrome in the womb, and she just recognizes so beautifully that every single life is valuable, every single life matters. And one of my favorite little sayings I saw on Twitter during the confirmation process was, someone had tweeted that he couldn't think of anything more feminist than a woman packing up her seven kids and her husband, moving across country to go be a Supreme Court justice. I mean, it's such a beautiful story that she is able to be so beloved as a mother, as a mama, and also to give the country so much and to help other mamas throughout our nation.
And also, let's not forget her husband. You know, yes. Obviously she has the support of her husband, and she exactly. is supportive of him. And just a little bit that you see of them interacting with one another, you can see that their affection for one another and their mutual support is really valuable. Mm-hmm. But her story and your story, this brings to mind something that you say about yourself and your organization, that you guys are, you've been in court on every pro-life case that there's been, if mm-hmm. I'm not mistaken. Well, what I want to get back to is the reliance interest that was articulated in the Planned Parenthood case. But before we do that, tell people just about AUL and what you guys do. What's your mission and how do you accomplish it?
Yeah, Americans United for Life, we advance the human right to life in culture, in law, and policy, working towards that day when every single human being is welcomed throughout life and protected in law. We work in a variety of different media, different venues. We work in Congress, in the state houses, in the state legislatures with the lawmakers there. We work in courts. We work to defend those laws, and we work with the public. So basically, our process is that we draft model bills. We work with lawmakers to get them passed. We make sure that these are bills that are going to stand up to constitutional muster, that are going to be good law. And right. so once they're passed, we then go to court and we work to defend those laws, as well as educating the public on why they're needed, on yes. just how abhorrent abortion is and why these laws are needed. Because when you look at the current state of the law in America, it's shameful in all yes. too many places. Yes. When you look at our national law in particular, and you see that we're in line with Canada, China, and North Korea.
Isn't that nice?
On our, in terms yep. of our abortion law, it's, mm-hmm. it's appalling, you know, not right. countries with stellar human rights records mm-hmm. in a lot of cases. Mm-hmm. So we tell people, we share the truth about abortion and abortion law, even as we're working to, you know, boots on the ground, work with the lawmakers to adapt those model bills to their states and get those bills passed and defended.
Well, you know, I'm in Louisiana, and here in Louisiana, we're one of the few states where a black woman Democrat would introduce pro-life legislation, but that's what we have over here. And as you know, we just got beat up by the Supreme Court that we had, what we thought should have been a good piece of legislation that got overturned by the Supreme Court. And right. one thing that I've tracked, and I'm sure you know this too, but when I wrote my book, The Sexual State, the Texas law had the comparable Texas law. So just tell everybody what these laws are we're talking about. These are health clinic regulation laws.
Right. What we're talking about here is laws that ensure that when a woman is in an abortion facility, getting an abortion, when things go wrong, as we know that sometimes all too often they do, that she is going to get every right, every chance at emergency care, that the emergency physicians will have every possible chance to save her life and her future fertility. And it seems common sense. It's the right. same kind of emergency transfer agreement for women to be transferred directly, easily from the abortion facility to the hospital that we see in any other kind of comparable surgery. And right. yet there's a carve out. There's a loophole for abortion.
Right.
So that was the law in Texas. It got struck down in 2016 in the Hellerstedt case. Similar Louisiana law, as you said, got struck down in just this year, just a
yes,
few months
exactly,
ago now.
Exactly.
At the end of June.
And the thing I discovered in doing my research on the sexual state, my book, The Sexual State, is that the legal arguments and the evidence that was brought forward by the other side to overturn those things, that there had been a 10-year plan financed by big foundations to, you know, sick a whole gang of academics on coming up with this research, you know. And I point to that and say, you know, look, this is not a level playing field whatsoever. You know, nobody elected the Ford Foundation to anything. You know, and right. yet these foundations come in and they empower one side of the equation disproportionately. And that's what you are dealing with every day, right?
That's absolutely right. Yeah. You know, when it came to that June Medical Services decision, came down at the end of June, it was devastating. It was devastating to see that the other side won. And I was just floored because of the way that it happened, because of what we knew about the court and the progress that we're making on the court. I was absolutely shocked. It was heartbreaking. And I felt maybe even a special pang being post-abortive, because it felt like the court was telling me that my life mattered less. My life would have mattered less if it had been in Louisiana and if something had gone, you know, medically wrong in that way. You know, we at Americans United for Life, we believe that all human rights flow from the human right to life, and that we're all equal members of the human family and equally worthy of respect and solidarity and love. And and that absolutely applies to children in the womb, to all human beings. And it felt like the Supreme Court was telling me that I didn't meet that that standard. Similar, actually, but we were talking about the reliance interest, mentioning that earlier. Similar to that, back in the Planned Parenthood v. Casey case in 1992, when the Supreme Court had the gall to tell women that women rely on abortion to succeed, that we can't compete on a level playing field with men, that we can't be active, be full participants in civil society, in the workforce, and volunteering and whatever we choose to do with men without access to legal abortion, that we can't plan for education or careers or families or futures without legalized abortion. I cannot think of a less feminist idea, of a less pro-woman idea from a body that claims to be pro-woman. So what they've told us over the last 30 years is that we have to have abortion because otherwise we're not good enough. And that when we do have an abortion, if something goes wrong, we're not good enough again. You know, if it's a man getting some other procedure, then, you know, of course he gets the emergency transfer agreement. We don't get that because it's abortion, because of the carve out. And that's appalling.
So even though we lost that particular law, the way he wrote the opinion opened the door for some other legislation to come through.
That's exactly important.
Yeah.
The Supreme Court is signaling that they're open to these kinds of laws. Mm-hmm. And so it was a devastating loss for the women of Louisiana, but overall it's a strategic win in the fight for life nationally.
Yes. And I would just want to say, as a resident of Louisiana, I want to give a big shout out to my friends at Louisiana Right to Life and the Louisiana Family Forum and all the other great people, because we just passed a pro-life amendment to our Constitution. So just so you know that we are still a very pro-life place over here. But back
God
to the reliance thing.
God bless you all on that. In fact, I recorded a video for that in support of that amendment. And it's just fantastic. The thing that I loved most, maybe, was that the data came out and showed that more people voted for Amendment 1 than voted for either President Trump or Vice President-elect Biden.
More
people voted for the pro-life amendment than for either presidential candidate. And I think that just shows the heart of the good people of Louisiana.
That's right.
That no matter what their political differences, they love life.
And they love their babies. They love their babies, you know, and they don't have the idea that your life will end if your pregnancy is somehow unplanned or unfortuitous or something like that. Somehow you figure it out. I do want to go back to this reliance interest, though, Catherine, because I'm an economist, okay, and my doctorate's in economics. And there is one sense in which that reliance interest that was articulated in Casey, there's one sense in which it was correct, if you want to say correct. And that is that if your goal is for men and women to earn the same amount of money at every stage in their career, then you have to somehow neutralize the babies. You know, the fact that women have babies and want to take care of them, by golly, they want to take care of them, that will create differences between men and women. And so if you're offended by those differences, then by golly, you got to do something about the babies. You got to somehow neutralize that. And that's what they really meant. You know, they don't have the nerve to say that, because as soon as you put it that bluntly, then it's clearly not pro-woman, right? And the feminists want to say, we're the only ones who are pro-woman. Amy's not pro-woman. Catherine's not pro-woman. Dr. Morris is not pro-woman. You know, we're the only ones who are pro-woman. It's like, get out of here. You know, I mean, what it means, what it's turned out to mean, is that feminism delivers women's bodies to the use of men without ever having the responsibility of fatherhood. And
that's exactly right.
And feminism delivers women's bodies to the workforce so that the employer never has to be inconvenienced by a woman who wants to take care of a baby. You know,
right.
That's what it's turned into. Isn't mm-hmm. that funny?
Right. It's become a very sterile type of society.
Huh.
And yeah, it takes away any notion of men and women being complementary,
right.
and just tries to make us the exact same.
Right.
And the way to do that is to, as you said, neutralize the babies. It's right. That's exactly right. I don't think that the Supreme Court has the courage to say that, because all of a sudden a lot of people would start seeing the light, blinders would come off.
Right.
But that is absolutely true.
And the other part of it is that the kind of person who's in the Supreme Court and who's making laws and who's making public opinion, those are people who really have neutralized their babies, a lot of them, not all of them, you know, but as a social class in general, you know, if you say what I just said, you know, you're kind of a pariah at the cocktail party, you know,
right.
And I'm like, so what? I'm way past caring about that. But
right.
But,
and Roe v. Wade came from seven men.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, exactly. So the next place I want to go with this conversation is to help people see how your work fits in with the broader pro-life movement. Because obviously not every pro-life person is going to be going to court or the state legislature or whatever. There's lots of different aspects to it.
Sure. You know, the pro-life movement has so many amazing parts, and everyone comes to the pro-life movement with their own story, their own motivation for
yes.
being here. And that's absolutely beautiful to me as well. When you talk with people who maybe are post-abortive, like myself, people who chose life, people who faced a difficult pregnancy, people who have experiences with adoption somewhere in their families, whether right. they themselves were adopted or adoptive parents or have an adopted sibling, all these different ways that people come. Sometimes it's just through a deep religious conviction or moral conviction and just knowing that life is the most fundamental of all human rights. And sometimes the way that people come will impact the part of the movement that they get involved in, right? So being a lawyer, I gravitated in a large part to the legal front of the movement. And some of the most important people in the movement and parts of the movement are the life-saving front work that the pro-life pregnancy centers bring, mm-hmm. You know, reaching the women where they are and offering the ultrasound that the abortion facilities don't show us, offering that window to the womb, offering hope and resources and life and support and courage, putting their arm around a woman and saying, it's okay, you've got
yeah.
this,
yeah.
you know, let's call that important person in your life and we'll tell them together that. That work takes so much courage, and I have been so privileged over the years to be able to partner with and serve with different pregnancy centers throughout our nation.
Right.
They do incredible work.
Right.
The sidewalk counselors also.
I was just
critical.
Thinking of them. Yeah, the
Absolutely.
Sidewalk counselors. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yes, another critical part. Again, meeting women where they are, just right on the sidewalk, right,
right.
in front of the abortion facility.
Right.
That last line of defense, saying, "There's another way.
Mm-hmm.
There's hope. There's help. Mm-hmm. Why don't you go to this pregnancy center down the street instead?" So
right.
Again, a critical part. All of the work that people do when it comes to bioethics and
yes.
And social science and the study and apologetics and getting good pro-life representatives and senators and administrations in place. The election part of it. You know, our work is vital because we're winning the fight when it comes to law and policy. And so we work alongside all of these different types of organizations. We work alongside the people who are getting the pro-life lawmakers in office, because
right.
once they're in office, then they come to us and they say, okay, we're here.
What do we do now?
Yeah, we're talking to our constituents. We need to know what to do. You know, what kinds of bills are the right, what's needed? What's the right thing to pass right now in our state? Right. Now, we believe at Americans United for Life, we believe in abolition, not just restriction and accommodation.
Right.
And we are striving towards the abolition of abortion and full respect for all Americans, no matter what their age or their size or their location or their economic value. We are there for it. But we're going to save every life that we can along the way and do everything that we can. So that's why we're working with lawmakers, not just at the federal level, where sometimes things move slowly, but at the state level, where on average, over the last decade, we've seen 60 pro-life bills signed into law every year.
Yes.
Close to half now of all the bills passed in the last 50 years. It's just an incredible time of support for life as state lawmakers really respond to their constituents. They listen to their constituents. They listen to the people that they're sworn to represent. And that really is I would just add true regardless of the demographics of their area. We know that more and more women and young people are supportive of life. They demand transparency and accountability and consistency. And they say, well, you know, if we're going to care for all human life the way you're telling us to, and we do, why does that stop in the womb?
Yes.
And so they are demanding consistency. We also know that even Democrats, about a third of all Democrats say that they are pro-life and at least oppose late-term abortion, at least favor full informed consent for women, good reporting. We know that that a majority of even self-described pro-choice people, even they oppose late-term abortion. So life is it's a winning issue.
Yes.
Life is an area where we can come together as a nation, and we need to keep fighting. We need to keep educating. We need to keep sharing the truth about abortion and about life and about science, and share those ultrasounds, the windows to the womb, and embryology, and all of the different pieces of what we do and what we study. But overall, people have a fundamental respect for life, a fundamental recognition that life does not begin in the hospital, in the birthing room, when the baby is out of the womb. But life begins before that. And so we just need to keep educating, but recognizing that we are winning, that the truth is winning, that justice is winning, and to coin a phrase, that we are on the right side of history.
Well, yeah. So tell me, are there issues besides abortion that you guys address, or are you pretty much only abortion?
No, we are full spectrum on life issues.
Okay.
We have testified.
Tell us about those. Yeah.
Yeah. In fact, during my time between working with Alliance Defending Freedom and joining Americans United for Life, one of my roles was serving as the executive director of Euthanasia Prevention Coalition USA. So I've worked on end of life issues, for example, for goodness, close to a decade now. That has been really near and dear to my heart. And Americans United for Life, we have testified against every effort to expand suicide by physician and euthanasia in the states. We are very, very involved in that. We also deal with a wide variety of other bioethics issues, denial of medical care, dealing with anything that impacts innocent human life, because we must value and protect all human life. And offering suicide, forcing euthanasia on people, that is never medical care. So we do handle the full spectrum of bioethical issues, and are very, very committed to every aspect of it. In fact, of the first three books that we published, we were founded back in 71. Of the first three books that we published, one was on abortion, sure, but two were on suicide and euthanasia.
Is that so? Is that
so?
Mm-hmm. How about the bioethics of assisted reproductive technology? Do you guys ever get into that?
We do, yeah. You know, we are non-sectarian, so we're willing to welcome everyone who's wanting to take up the fight for the human right to life. So so whenever it does touch on, we don't address the full breadth of it, but anytime that a life is in danger, we are there. Anytime we're talking
embryo destruction, embryo destruction would be an issue that you guys would be concerned
about. Absolutely. Yes. Very, very concerned about that. We have a model bill on that subject. And in fact, I have, prior to my time at Americans United for Life, I filed a lawsuit on that very issue. In fact, in Louisiana.
Yes.
That is, it's a critical issue for our nation. We have hundreds of thousands of embryos frozen.
Yes.
In our nation.
Yes. And in fact, we don't even know how many. I mean,
exactly.
The last time I looked, we don't even know how many. That's how cheap it is,
right.
You know, that
exactly.
That people aren't even required to keep track of it. At the Ruth
exactly.
Institute, we're a full service organization as far as
yes.
the marriage and family formation aspect of it is, which the life and the marriage issues are in a way really one giant issue, you know.
They really are.
And so I know that a lot of our people are going to be interested in this mm-hmm. conversation and what you guys do and getting involved. So mm-hmm. tell people what they can do to get involved with you at Americans United for Life. How can they be involved? How can they help?
Well, like I said, we want to hear from everyone who cares about life, and our supporters, our partners, our allies encompass a beautiful cross-section of the nation, men and women, people who are religiously convicted, who share that faith, and also those who do not believe. We are just Americans, literally united for life.
Yes.
And the core part of that, what makes our supporters really so special, is that they all share in common the belief in the inherent value of human life. And how they come to that conviction may differ, but the common outcome allows everyone, all of us, to work together, because there's room for everyone in the pro-life movement. There's a place for everyone
yes.
in the pro-life movement. And we
yes.
want to hear from everyone. We want to hear your life story. We're collecting the story of Americans across the spectrum as it relates
to abortion.
Oh,
is that right? Is that right?
Yes.
You're
yes.
like doing interviews and things like that? And
yes.
is there a place people can go to submit their stories or something?
There is, yes. It's aul.org/mylifestory.
Oh, cool.
I shared my story here with you today, but I would invite all of your viewers to share their stories with me if they have any kind of connection to abortion or a challenging pregnancy, if maybe they chose life in the midst of a difficult time. That is, it's so critical to share those stories in particular.
Yes.
Quick backstory there. One of the things that I love sharing about is how our stories can impact others.
Yes.
There are a couple of competing effects in the media and in popular culture, just around our water coolers or over the fence with our neighbors or whatever it may be, sharing in the pews at church. We have a life-giving effect. It's called the Papageno effect. And life inspires life. When we share stories of people who chose life in difficult circumstances, when we share stories of people who even chose death, chose abortion, but then you hear that story of redemption mm-hmm. and of how they transformed their lives, how God transformed their lives, that inspires others to follow suit, to say, I can do this. I'm strong
yes.
enough. I can handle it. I will choose life too. And so we just are about sharing those stories, stories like mine. I would love to hear the stories of your viewers. And if your viewers are ready to share, I would just ask them to go to aul.org/mylifestory. And we would love to talk with you and communicate with you. It can be anonymous, or we can build a relationship. But I love hearing from people all across the nation and all across the world.
Well, that's a very beautiful thing, because one of the things that we feel very strongly here at the Ruth Institute also is that the people who are what we call the victims or survivors of the sexual revolution, their stories are the ones that need to be told. And so your people who have triumphed over adversity, or the people who have done the wrong thing and went, oh, criminy, that really didn't work, the mainstream media never wants to hear from those people. So what you're doing with that My Life Story part is very consistent with our overall strategy, you know, of people telling their story about their unwanted divorce or, you know, all the other issues that are surrounding the sexual revolution. So I, Dr. J, totally endorse what she just said. Everyone should go over there and do that. I'm sure they have a very professional setup where you can share your story and where they will share it and publicize it in a very appropriate manner. So Catherine, do you have any final words for our viewers?
I am just, I'm so grateful for you and all of the work that you're doing with the Ruth Institute. It's critical. It's transforming our nation. And as we work together, as we link arms, your organization, my organization, pro-life Americans across the spectrum, as we see more and more every year, I think back to that quote from the then head of NARAL. She showed up at the March for Life in January. She showed up at Union Station, a few blocks from the U.S. Supreme Court, right in the midst of the March for Life. And she gets off the metro train and steps out into a crowd, a sea of young people. And she said, my goodness, there are so many of them. There are so many of them, and they're so young.
Yeah.
I think back to the cover we actually made. The front page A1 above the fold cover story of the New York Times back in 2017, New York Times and Washington Post. And try as they might, they could not hide the energy, the vitality, the youth in those images. This is, it's a movement for everyone. It's a winning movement. It's a movement of truth and of justice. And I just love that that I can speak with you, that we can communicate with Americans from coast to coast in collecting stories and just sitting down and sharing what we've done and in working together to build a culture of life.
Well, that's a great place to start. And I just want to add that there's something for everyone to do, no matter how old you are, no matter what your skill set is. You show up and you hang around here, we'll find something for you to do. So, Catherine Glenn Foster, thank you so very much for being my guest on the Dr. J Show, and thank you for your work at Americans United for Life. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse for the Ruth Institute.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.